करुणानन्दरसानुभूति सहित स्मेर प्रसन्नाननम् पूर्णेन्दु प्रभमात्मबोधनिलयम् शान्तम् निरीहम् परम् नित्यविचारसारचतुरम् निर्मत्सरम् पावनम् श्रीभूमानन्दमहं नतोऽस्मि कलितानन्दम् परम् श्रेयसे.
We shall start the session with an invocation which primarily is meant to generate a sublime force or power which will be enabling you to fulfill your noble and benevolent desires. Then we shall have a chorus recitation of the Omkara. Omkara does not have a religious connotation as many of you may think of. The letter or the sound syllable, monosyllable as we call it, is a combination of three syllables coming out of the human mouth. All of them, when properly studied and represented, you will find they signify the entire gamut of knowledge articulated by the human mouth. It is a representative of all the sounds articulated by us, every sound denoting and conveying a measure and a kind of an idea, the unit of knowledge. That is the idea with which we recite and give an opportunity to the participants also to participate in the chorus recitation. That can be a very good beginning for any kind of an interaction, communication like this. Harihi, Harihi.
Yam Shaiva Samupasate Shivaidi ब्रह्मेति वेदांतिनो बौद्धा बुद्धैति प्रमाणपडवः कर्तेति नैयायिकाः अर्हन् नित्यथ जैन शासनरताः कर्मेति मीमांसकाः सोऽयं वो विदधातु वाञ्छितफलं त्रैलोक्यनाथो हरिः सोऽयं वो विदधातु वाञ्छितफलं त्रैलोक्यनाथो हरिः मदीयहृदयाकाशे सदानन्दमयो गुरुः उदेतु सततं सम्यक् अज्ञान तिमिरारुणः
हरिः ओम हरिः. Now we shall have the recitation in chorus. Interlock your fingers and put them on your lap. Sit comfortably erect without causing any strain for you. Close your eyes, open the mouth and the heart and join me. Our idea must be that this chorus recitation should permeate not merely the subcontinent of India, but the entire globe, generating its sublime and benedictory influence, bestowing peace, contentment, and fulfillment to all the beings. Such a noble thought itself is very elevating, and expansive also. Very rarely people think about these matters. So this is a great occasion for all of you. Without feeling shy or having any other kind of inhibition, join me very liberally. Harihi, Harihi, Harihi. Join me.
Oh.
Master. Jaya Guru. Dear and blessed souls, seekers of knowledge, I am very happy to be in the midst of all of you for a short spell like this, discussing a subject which is not a subject of the present. I think it has been an eternal subject and will continue to be so without any question or the least iota of doubt. While discussing the subject, I would like to present to you, in relation to the history of our own country and what they thought, did, pursued and attained in the sphere of peace, contentment and joy for the mind. It could have been a secret, but in this country it is not, because the secret was unveiled right from the prehistoric times. Many of you may not know that we were research-oriented right from the past. As far as I can think of, so far as our civilization is concerned, when in the Indo-Gangetic plain Indian civilization started sprouting, it was in the prehistoric times. Right then I find sufficient indications as to how our people were research-oriented. You will find many of the temples in our land are installed at the point of origin of rivers. River is something that flows down in the plains, and civilization thrives always on the bank of perennial rivers. Our civilization also had its thriving on the Gangetic plain. They wanted to research into and find out where from Ganga has its origin. This is a research point of view, mind. They were also trying to find out what is the source of water, source of air, source of fire, and source of even space. Perhaps many of you may not know this, but you find clear indications as to how our people were search and research oriented in whatever they did. When our first and even much later thoughts in the sphere of research, nature, etc., throw in our country, I would like you to understand the word religion had not found its place in the English dictionary. Religion as a word came into the English dictionary only in 1700. And even if you think about the word, it means re and logo. It means tracing back the source. Religion is actually exhorting everyone to trace back his or her own source. Our body biologically has been shaped and is born of the mother's womb. But does the womb have the capacity to design the body? What is that wonderful power? Our body is a matter-energy aggregate, so is the world also. Neither matter nor energy has the power and potential to think, to feel, to sense, to comprehend, to understand, to inquire into, investigate, evaluate, find out, assess, discover, invent. None of these properties is there with matter and energy. Naturally, there must be a factor besides matter and energy to which we can possibly ascribe whatever we want to ascribe. So even in the genesis of the child, you will find there is a deep point of inquiry. And you will find this in our Vedic hymns and recitations. Ano bhadraha kratavo yantu vishvadaha, declares Rigveda, the earliest prehistoric ones. From all over the world, may noble thoughts enter my heart, is the meaning. This will give you an idea as to how the individual of India was inclined to think in his sober moments of inquiry and aspiration. Something that you should always do, you will do well to inquire into. Our subject is not a new subject. It is an old subject. And it is an indispensable subject. As long as human beings are alive, you will find
the quest for peace and contentment and the source of it, the secret of it, will have to be unveiled. And everyone is anxiously looking for it. In any matter whatsoever, according to me, history is the best teacher. Will you agree with me when I say this? The complaint history has against mankind is that, my dear men, my dear humanity, you refuse to learn from me. And there is a celebrated statement that history repeats itself. You know why history repeats itself? The biology of man, human body, his psychology, his psychic elements, if at all, in him, all of them are eternal. The ancient man and the modern man have the same body, the same set of eyes, ears, etc. Equally the same emotional mind, rational intelligence, and an asserting ego. These were what they were. The same are even today. And in terms of the world also broadly, the five elements, panchabhutas as we call them, the earth, the water, the air, the fire, and the space, they are also the same. Panchabhutas have not changed, will not change perhaps. And the human, as a biological aggregate and a psycho-intellectual inner counterpart, that man also has not changed. So naturally, the quest is not a new quest. It's a very ancient quest. Naturally, this must have been pursued by our people. And our history must be able to reveal it. So I would like to present to you the historic element, the historic representation of this quest, how our people handled it, and how they succeeded in unveiling the secret and making use of it. Am I right? Are you ready for it? When I refer to history, history is a teacher for me. Unfortunately, we don't have a proper history. But the history I'm referring to is not by our modern historians. I only will refer to two historic documents of our country. One is Ramayana, written by sage Valmiki. We have never seen him. We don't have a picture of Valmiki. We don't have the original palm leaf scripture he wrote on. We don't have a photograph of his hermitage. But the original writing of his continues to be available before us. And this happened in Treta Yuga, means many, many millennia before history. How did our people preserve this wonderful writing, historic document? It is for every one of you moderners to think seriously about it. Is there any society upon this earth who has been able to preserve a historic narration intact for countless millennia? And one more special factor, history is generally written by authors centuries after the incidents and events have taken place. But our history depicted in Ramayana, all the instances took place when the author Valmiki was present and he became a part of the narrative. Are you hearing me? Are you? Please understand it. So I like to call it concurrent history. It is not a history posthumously written. Written while the incidents were taking place and the author was a part of it. When Sita was abandoned by Rama, Rama said, abandon her at the doors of Valmiki, the sage. She wanted to have a period of life, a short session with a saint during pregnancy. It would be good for children. So under that pretext, Lakshmana, you take her and leave her at his gate and come back. Tell her that I have abandoned. So even King Rama, dependent upon the magnanimity and magnificence of sage Valmiki to ensure safety for his abandoned wife. My dear souls, this is India for me. I am not referring to an industrial India or merely an agricultural India. I am referring to a cultural India. I am referring to a psycho-intellectual, splendorous India. A king had the trust
that a saint who had abandoned his wife and children and was living in solitude would still take pity and sympathy for the abandoned pregnant wife of his and would ensure everything safe. And he did so. From that moment onwards, the biography that he was writing became autobiographical. Am I clear? So far as the next history which I am speaking about today, Mahabharata, it has got a much more recent origin. Mahabharata was written, according to our available records and verification, 5,155 years ago. Mark, 5,155 years back, Mahabharata was written by Vyasadeva. And the entire Mahabharata is a narration on the decline and fall of the Hastinapura dynasty. We have two dynasties, solar and lunar. Sri Rama, Dasaratha and the others belong to the solar dynasty. And Hastinapura dynasty, where Bhishma, Shantanu, Dhritarashtra, Pandava, etc., all of them, they belong to lunar dynasty. Both the dynasties are extinct now. But what transpired spiritually and culturally during their reign and during the fall and decline still survives. We are adepts in preserving whatever is benevolent, useful, eternal and beneficial. We discard the rest of the details. So this Mahabharata was the life history, the actions, adventures, exploits, fates, plights, etc., everything of the Kuru dynasty. And Vedavyasa was speaking about his own children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, etc., altogether six generations from him, ending up with Janamejaya. Are you following me? Huh? Please understand, he was writing on himself, his children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, ending up with Janamejaya. That is why I call it autobiography. So it has got so much of authenticity, veracity, unchallengeable content and greatness. It was not merely history, a table of events. Normally history is only a table of events. So it should describe the events, and to whomever the events were related, allied details about persons, places, purposes. Finally, it revolves upon the character, behavior and interaction of the people. Am I right or not? Huh? Why a certain person behaves in a certain manner? Because it is his characteral composition. So character is invisible, behavior is visible. And when the behavior becomes between himself and another, it becomes interaction. So our historic narrations present to you all the sets of facts and figures, plus what was the cause of these facts and phenomena? What played the trick? Wherein lay either right or wrong? If the Hastinapura dynasty declined and fell, why did the decline start? How did it fall? Where was the error? That is why it is called epic narration. The epic narration is very particular that if X has spoken something, they will say X spoke in this manner and why he spoke it. If there was destruction, why did it invite destruction? What was the reason? What was fundamentally or basically wrong? If X was not destroyed, what was the factor which enabled him to survive? So it is a very descriptive and authentic narration. Now I am going to speak from Mahabharata. You know why? Personal stories are the prevailing influence in humanity at any point of time. I shall stop for a while. Personal stories are the prevailing influence in humanity at any time. Do you agree or disagree? There is no point in talking empty words. Tell me whether the words are true. Are they true of the human, his mind, his intelligence, his heart? Is it practical? Was there any instance where whatever you say was true, was put into test? So is it time tested? All these things we want to know.
Mahabharata is only such a narration. It is purely historic. There is nothing religion about it at all. It was a narration of the decline and fall of the Kuru dynasty that ruled India for a while. Ruled India for a while. Whatever they said, whatever they did, whatever they thought, however they interacted with, what was their behavior like, what motivated the behavior, all these are clearly mentioned there. So it's a very, very descriptive, self-evaluative grantha or record. I consider a society to be great only when the society is able to produce something in the form of an eternal literature. Our archaeology department is always looking for evidences. Evidences of what? You tell me. Inert things, things which we have used, the vessels and other things, if they are buried in the earth, they will excavate it to find out the age of civilization, etc. This is what they are doing. Archaeology is only interested in that. But so far as we are concerned, we are thinking that a society will be great only when it is able to produce a literature. And that literature should be such that it should be able to survive eternally with an ever-renewed relevance to the further and further generations. Imagine Ramayana written in Rama's time, and even now thousands and millions of people are reading Ramayana. How many trillions of copies of Ramayana have been printed and circulated? In how many hearts Sri Rama is installed? It was only because of the splendid nature of the writing of sage Valmiki. Before Sri Rama, there were good princes in the Ikshvaku dynasty, but we know nothing about them. Sri Rama became famous only when there was an author to give him a historic pen. That was the reason. Do you agree or disagree? We take Rama and forget the author. Thereby we distance ourselves from the purpose for which Valmiki wrote. So we have a literature. This literature is the memorial of India. Memorial of India. When a committee was appointed during the interim government to form our constitution, they deliberated and finally produced the first constitution. In the first constitution, the first picture on the first page was Ramayana. And in the second page was Krishna and Arjuna and Gita. Do you know it? Huh? Please understand. I saw a picture where the law minister was showing all this. He took the book, Constitution, and said, here is it. They removed it. And they wanted to restrict themselves to the British ruled India. Did they rule India or misrule India? It's a vital question that I am asking you. I am concerned with. I am first and last a patriot, much more than any political man can think of. Ours is cultural patriotism. And it links itself to India. Infinite number of years it is old. We want to live in this country, drop our body in this country. If there is a further birth, we would like to be born here again. We will be never enamored of the West. We are never enamored of the nuclear factories, plants. No, no, no. We can produce electricity from the sea. Enough electricity through windmill for the whole requirement of the earth. I read in a newspaper the other day. Did you read? Through windmill installed in the sea, we will get as much electricity as we want for the people of the earth. We want to produce things without causing harm and without breeding hazards. Can there not be a sustainable, a benevolent civilization? This is the quest. This was the quest of our people. Unfortunately, we have dropped it. That is why I thought of telling you something about the history of the country. In any kind of a historic narration, the background and the foreground of the events depicted should be very clearly there. The first is Ramayana, the second is Mahabharata.
I have got very clear writing before me to say that our India was very prosperous up to 1700 years. In 1700, 24.4% was the share of India in the world economy. In 1700. And after Britishers ruled us, it went down to 4.2% in 1950. My dear souls, you are all professionals. You should voice yourself. This is the India that you are referring to. We don't want anybody's favor or mercy to grow. We have enough strength, enough intelligence, enough resolve, enough determination, enough dedication, enough commitment, enough perseverance. We have. We don't lack. Hanuman is our example. Harishchandra is our model. The entire life of Mahatma Gandhi was shaped by Harishchandra. What do you think of it? We lack nothing. Britishers came here to misrule the country and rob all our riches. When Robert Clive was the governor of West Bengal, he loaded 600 ships with gold, gems and other things, golden items, and shipped them to British Island. And he said, "This is only a tip of the iceberg. I am astonished at my moderation," he said. Where from did India have so much of money? Tell me. Are we a poor nation? We are not poor. We are rich enough. If our rich people will feel a little liberal towards the poor, and we will have a stable administration who can contain the wrong hands of the country, I think India will become prosperous in 5 to 10 years. Law enforcement machinery should be very forceful and powerful. That is where we lack. Humanity has never become benevolent all through. That is all the 100% any time. There will be some people who are benign, benevolent. There will equally be some people who are malignant and maleficent. They should be kept under the rule of law. What the law can do, you and I will not be able to do. A thief is thieving. How can I restrain him? The power to restrain him, stop anybody on the road, is only given to the police. So the police people will have to be very vigilant. And they will have to be sometimes even ruthless in dealing with ruthless people. It cannot be done by you and me. What cannot be done by the country, I cannot understand. We were blaming that Britishers were robbing us. Now after we have got India in our own hands, you tell me, have we been robbed more or less?